In our today's lecture, we will talk about the pelvic girdle and the lower limbs, and we will look at all the bones that are involved in the formation of the pelvic girdle and the bones that are involved in the lower limbs. So we will start from the pelvic girdle, and before discussing it, let's look at the images. So basically, the pelvic girdle is formed from the two innominate bones. Innominate bones are also called the hip bones, and when I'm talking about the two innominate bones, that means a left-sided hip bone and a right-sided hip bone. They both will join and form the pelvic girdle. And the pelvis is a term that is used to describe a structure that is basin-shaped. And the pelvis is formed by the pelvic girdle, that I have already told you that the pelvic girdle is formed from the two innominate bones and its associated sacrum. So the pelvis will be formed by the pelvic girdle and its associated sacrum, and the pelvic girdle alone will be formed by the two innominate bones that are also called the hip bones. So this is a hip bone, and you can see three bones that are fused and they are forming the hip bone. So this part of the innominate bone, this bone is called the ilium, and this bone that is forming the inferior and posterior part, this is called ischium, and this bone that is lying anteriorly, this bone is called the pubis. And you can see that these three bones are fusing at the point, the ilium, ischium and pubis. All bones are fusing at this point, which is called the acetabulum of the hip bone. This acetabulum, just like the glenoid fossa of scapula, forms a ball and socket joint with the head of the femur, which is the hip joint. Now we will talk about the hip bone, and you can see this upper flattened part of the ilium bone, and this is called the iliac crest. This upper flattened part is called the iliac crest. The interior curve of this iliac crest is called the anterior superior iliac spine, and the anterior curve that is inferiorly, this is called the anterior inferior iliac spine. So first of all, this flattened upper part of the ilium bone is what we are calling the iliac crest, and this anterior curve of the iliac crest is what we are calling the anterior superior iliac spine, and it is superiorly. The curve part that is inferiorly and anteriorly, this is called anterior inferior iliac spine. So you can palpate this part in your pelvic area, which is the anterior superior iliac spine. Next, we will talk about the pubis, and pubis is the interior part of the innominate bone, and it articulates with the pubis of another bone, and this is what they form. We call it the pubic symphysis or the symphysis pubis, and this is a cartilaginous joint. So the pubic bones of both innominate bones are forming a joint interiorly, and we are calling it the pubic symphysis or symphysis pubis. Now we will talk about the ischium, and ischium is the inferior and posterior part, and it also has the inferior projection, which is called the ischial tuberosity. And these ischial tuberosities are the weight bearing part of the body when you sit. So when you sit, use it on your ischial tuberosities. Once again, this is an innominate bone or the hip bone, and there are three parts of an innominate bone: the ilium, ischium, and the pubis. The ilium is this part, and it has upper flattened part which we call the iliac crest, and this interior curved part we call the interior spiracalic spine, and this inferior curved is what we call the interior inferocalic spine. Then we talked about the pubis, and we said that the pubis is the interior part of the hip bone, and we said that it forms a joint with the other innominate bone, a cartilaginous joint, and we are calling it the symphysis pubis or pubic symphysis. Next, we talked about the ischium bone, and we said that it forms posterior and the inferior part of the innominate bone, and then we talked about the inferior projection that we named the ischial tuberosities. So they help you in sitting, and you sit on your ischial tuberosities. The lower limb forms a joint with the trunk at the pelvic girdle. The pelvic girdle is formed from the two innominate hip bones. The pelvis is the term given to the basin-shaped structure formed by the pelvic girdle that we talked about, that the pelvic girdle was formed by the two innominate bones and its associated sacrum. Innominate hip bones. Each hip bone consists of three fused bones, the ilium, ischium, and pubis. On its lateral surface is a deep depression, the acetabulum, which forms the hip joint with the almost spherical head of the femur. The ilium is the upper flattened part of the bone, and it presents the iliac crest, the interior curve of which is called the interior spiracalic spine. The ilium forms a synovial joint with the sacrum, the sacroiliac joint, a strong joint capable of absorbing the stresses of weight bearing, and which tends to become fibrosed in the later life. So, as we have already discussed, that these three bones, ilium, ischium, and pubis, fuse at this point, which is called the acetabulum, and the head of the femur joins with the acetabulum and forms the hip joint. Here you can appreciate another joint, which is between the sacrum and the innominate bone, and we are calling it the sacroiliac joint because the joint is between the ilium and the sacrum. That's why we are calling it the sacroiliac joint, and it fibrosed at later life. The pubis is the interior part of the bone, and it articulates with the pubis of other hip bone at a cartilaginous joint, the symphysis pubis. The ischium is the inferior and the posterior part. The rough inferior projections of the ischia, the ischial tuberosities, bear the weight of the body when seated. The union of the three parts take place in the acetabulum. The pelvis. The pelvis is formed by the hip bones, the sacrum, and the coccyx. It is divided into upper and lower parts by the brim of the pelvis, consisting of the promontory of the sacrum and the iliopectineal lines of the innominate bones. The greater or false pelvis is above the brim, and the lesser or true pelvis is below them. Okay, so this is the pelvis, which is a basin-shaped structure, and it is formed by the pelvic girdle, by the two innominate bones, and the associated sacrum, and the coccyx. Now, we talked about the pelvic brim and the true and false pelvis, and we will look at these now. So, these are the iliopectineal lines, and this is the promontory of the sacrum. Above this the part of the pelvis is called the false pelvis, and below this is called the true pelvis. There are differences between the male and the female pelvis. The shape of the female pelvis allows for the passage of the baby during the childbirth. In comparison with the male pelvis, the female pelvis has lighter bones, is more shallow and rounded, and is generally roomier. So let's look at the difference between the female and the male pelvis. This is the male pelvis, and this one is the female pelvis. So the bones are lighter in the female pelvis as compared to the male pelvis. They are heavier and thicker. The false pelvis, which is above the promontory and the iliopectoral lines, are shallow in the female pelvis and they are deep in the male pelvis. The pelvic cavity is wider and shallow for the easy passage and provide a room for the growing fetus. So it's more roomier as compared to the male pelvis. The pelvic inlet, this part, this is heart shaped in male, and the pelvic inlet in the female is more rounded or oval, and it is large as compared to the male pelvis. Another thing is this arch, this pubic arch, and there is an angle as well. We call it the subpubic angle, and the subpubic angle is large, or we can say that the subpubic angle is acute in the male pelvis, and the subpubic angle is greater than the 90 degrees in the female pelvis, and it is lesser than 70 degrees in the male pelvis. So these are some of the differences between the male and the female pelvis, and I have given a table that can help you in remembering the differences. Next, we will talk about the lower limb, and we already know that the bones that are involved in the lower limb are the femur, which is also called the thigh bone, tibia, which is also called the shin bone, fibula, and the seven tarsal bones, metatarsal bones, and the phalanges, and also the patella. So let's look at the femur first, and this is a long bone. It has a head which is going to take part in the formation of the hip joint, and the joint will be the ball and socket type. This narrow part is what we call the neck of the femur. This is the greater trochanter for the attachment of the muscles. The lesser trochanter, this is also for the muscle attachment. This is the shaft of the femur, and neck is mostly encapsulated. Next, we have the medial and the lateral epicondyles, just above the lateral and the medial condyles. These are the ridges. Then there is the groove for the patella, which accommodates the patella for the formation of the knee joint. This lateral condyle is the lateral part of the hinge joint that is formed with the tibia, and we call it the knee joint. This is the medial condyle. Next, we have the tibia and fibula. Tibia is on the medial side, and the fibula is the bone that lies on the lateral side. So the proximal part of these two bones have the condyles, the articular surfaces for the medial and the lateral condyles of the femur. The fibula has a head in its proximal part, and it will join with the tibia and form the proximal tibiofibular joint. This is the anterior crest of the tibia, and between these two bones you can appreciate the interosseous membrane. At the proximal parts, they have medialis, the lateral medialis formed by the fibula, and the median medialis, that is the part of the tibia, and you can feel them near your ankle joint. Then we have the seven tarsal bones. The first bone is the calcaneus, which is also called the heel bone, talus, which is this bone here. Third one is the navicular. Then we have the three cuneiforms, medial cuneiform lying on the medial side of the body, the intermediate cuneiform, and the lateral cuneiform, and then we have the cuboid. Then these are the metatarsal bones, the five metatarsals from medial to lateral. Then we have the phalanx and phalanges, and just like in the hand, we have two phalanx in the big toe and three in the fingers. Also the patella, which is a roughly triangular shaped bone, which is also called the kneecap, and this is a sesamoid bone. It has a base, it has a medial and a lateral fossa, it has an apex, which is this pointed part. So the femur, which is also called the thigh bone. The femur is the longest and the heaviest bone of the body. The head is almost spherical and fits into the acetabulum of the hip bone to form the hip joint. The neck extends outwards and slightly downwards from the head to the shaft, and most of it is within the capsule of the hip joint. The posterior surface of the lower third forms a flat triangular area called the popliteal surface. The distal extremity has two articular condyles, which with the tibia and patella form the knee joint. The femur transmits the weight of the body through the bones below the knee to the foot. Next is the tibia, which is a shin bone. The tibia is the medial of the two bones of the lower leg. The proximal extremity is broad and flat and presents two condyles for the articulation with the femur and the knee joint. The head of the fibula articulates with the inferior aspect of the lateral condyle, forming the proximal tibiofibular joint. The distal extremity of the tibia forms the ankle joint with the talus and the fibula. The medial medialis is a downward projection of the bone medial to the ankle joint. So once again, this is the tibia and this is the fibula. The tibia has articular surfaces for the medial and lateral condyles of the femur to form the knee joint, and at its distal end you can appreciate these two projections, downward projections, and these are the lateral and the medial medialis. The medial medialis is a part of the tibia, and the lateral medialis is a part of the fibula. And the head of fibula is forming the proximal tibiofibular joint with the lateral condyle of the tibia. Okay, next we have the patella, which is also called the kneecap, and this is a roughly triangular shaped sesamoid bone associated with the knee joint. Its posterior surface articulates with the patellar surface of the femur in the knee joint, and its interior surface is in the patellar tendon, that is the tendon of the quadriceps femoris muscle. Next we have the tarsals, ankle bones. There are 7 tarsal bones that we just saw, forming the posterior part of the foot, are the talus, that we call the ankle bone as well, calcaneus, navicular, cuboid, and the 3 cuneiform bones. The talus articulates with the tibia and fibula at the ankle joint. The calcaneus forms the heel of the foot. The other bones articulate with each other and with the metatarsal bones. So this is the talus, which is also called the ankle bone, forming the ankle joint with the tibia and fibula. Next, we have the metatarsals. These are the 5 bones numbered from inside out, which form the greater part of the dorsum, sole of the foot. At their proximal ends, they articulate with the tarsal bones, and at their distal ends with the phalanges. The enlarged distal head of the first metatarsal bone forms the ball of the foot. So this part is what that forms the ball of your first toe. Next we have phalanges. There are 14 phalanges arranged in a similar manner to those in the fingers, that is 2 in the great toe and 3 in each of the other toes. Now we will talk about the arches of the foot, and these arches are really very important because they help you in standing for the longer period of time, and they also help in bearing the weight. So there are 3 arches: the medial longitudinal arch, the lateral longitudinal arch, and the transverse arch. And there are also ligaments associated with these arches. This is the longitudinal arch lying on the lateral side, so we will call it the lateral longitudinal arch. And the one that is on the side of your big toe, we will call it that the medial longitudinal arch. This is the transverse arch, and there are associated muscles and the ligaments as well to support it. The first muscle that we are going to talk about is the posterior tibialis muscle that we have already discussed in our previous lecture. It lies on the posterior aspect of the lower leg, and it originates from the middle third of the tibia and fibula, and its tendon, you can see here, this tendon is passing behind the medial malleolus, that was a downward projection of the tibia, and it is inserting into the navicular, cuneiform, cuboid, and the metatarsal bones. And this is a very supporting structure for the longitudinal arch. Then there are some short muscles as well, and that is a group of muscles, and it is mainly concerned with the maintenance of the longitudinal and the transverse arches. and they form the fleshy part of the sole of the foot. Then we have the spring ligament, which is also called the plantar calcaneonavicular ligament, the spring ligament, or which we also called the plantar calcaneonavicular ligament. And this is a very strong, thick ligament stretching from the calcaneus to the navicular bone, and it plays a very important role in supporting the medial longitudinal arch. So the arrangement of the bones in the foot, supported by the associated ligaments and action of associated muscles, gives the sole of the foot an arch or curved shape. The curve running from the heel to the toe is called longitudinal arch, and the curve running across the foot is called the transverse arch. In the normal longitudinal arch, only the calcaneus and the distal ends of the metatarsals should touch the ground, the bones in between being lifted clear. This gives the conventional footprint shape. If, however, the concavity of the sole is lost because of the sagging ligaments or the tendons, the arch sinks and much more of the sole of the foot is in contact with the ground. This is called the flat foot. So some people with the flat foot have a difficulty in standing for the longer period of time. Their feet become sore when they stand for the long for a long period of time. So that's the reason, because they have the sagging ligaments. Their ligaments are not strong to support these arches, and they are less concave and more in contact with the ground. Because arches of the foot are important in distributing the weight of the body evenly whilst upright, whether stationary or moving, the flat foot loses the springiness of normal foot structure and leads to the sore feet when standing, walking or running for the long periods. As there are movable joints between all the bones of the foot, very strong muscles and ligaments are necessary to maintain the strength, resilience and the stability of the foot during the walking, running and standing. So these are the muscle, tendons and the ligaments involved to support these arches. The posterior tibialis muscle. This is the most important muscular support of the longitudinal arch. It lies on the posterior aspect of the lower leg, originates from the middle third of the tibia and fibula, and its tendon passes behind the medial malleolus to be inserted into the navicular, cuneiform, cuboid and the metatarsal bones, and it acts as a sling or suspension apparatus for the arch. Next we have the short muscles of the foot. This group of muscles is mainly concerned with the maintenance of the longitudinal and the transverse arches. They make up the fleshy part of the sole of the foot. Then the spring ligament, which is also called the plantar calcaneonavicular ligament. This is a very strong, thick ligament stretching from the calcaneus to the navicular. Because it is stretching from the calcaneus to the navicular, that's why we are calling it the calcaneonavicular ligament as well. It plays an important role in supporting the medial longitudinal arch. Plantar ligaments and the introitus membranes support the lateral and the transverse arches. So these are the associated ligaments and the muscle tendon to support the arches. This is the tendon of the posterior tibialis muscle. Then we have the short plantar ligaments. The spring ligament, which is also called the calcaneonavicular ligament. So that's all for today, and if you have any question regarding this lecture, then you can ask. Thank you so much.